Welcome back to our Lieutenant novel study. It's been a couple of years, but we're going to commence from page 192, and we're going to do a little section, just a really quick section, up to page 199. It is the flogging of the prisoner. And so have your highlighters, have your pencils, pens ready to annotate, and we're going to summarize the plot, and we're going to do a bit of analysis as we go. Our location starts in the settlement, and Rook is in the settlement. He's sending messages to Silk, who's in Rose Hill, and he sends off a messenger when another arrives to summon him to the parade ground. And a parade ground is not a parade like what we think of as a festival-like parade. It's a military parade, yeah? And so a prisoner has been caught digging up potatoes in the government garden and secreting them under his coat, and he was to be flogged. That is whipped. The standard punishment at the time. So Rook knew that the settlement could not tolerate the theft of food. It's a crime. No one could argue with that. But hunger was beginning to dominate everyone's days. The prisoner women had scoured around the shoreline, and they picked off every limpet and winkle, but they are pale and scrawny. Remember, they are starving, essentially. And the only one who looks actually robust is the gamekeeper, Brugden. So the suggestion is maybe he's eating what he shoots out in the woods rather than actually bringing it back for everybody. And as for this poor devil, sympathy and at the same time the devil might be a bit of anger, they'd taken the potatoes. Well, look, man was an organism that demanded food. To take food when it was available, purely in scientific terms, a correct response to hunger. So if you're hungry, people steal food. And maybe the problem is not so much the theft, but more the hunger and the fact that people are starving. Don't know what the solution is, but still, theft is, it's like, oh, this prisoner, should he really be flogged, I think, is that suggestion. That we can, Rook, through the narrative perspective of Rook, we can kind of see him sympathizing with and understanding the actions of the prisoner, and perhaps recognizing that although it's theft and this is the punishment, he also understands. But there is this hard-faced judgment, which is the imperial military machine. So the Her Majesty's government calls the action theft. Sorry, His Majesty. And so, as a servant of His Majesty, Rook was obliged to obey, but he wished the prisoner had not stolen the potatoes. See links there to Gardiner's comment that he wished he had not obeyed that order, that he was that unjust order that he was forced to obey. He wished the prisoner hadn't stolen the potatoes. He wished he had not tried to hide them under his coat, and he wished he hadn't been caught. So the man itself, his fair hair, curly hair, and his sweating, because his body knew what was coming. And the Marines in their red coats are obliged to be present. That word obliged is there a lot. It's being forced. Okay. What was the point of punishment if no one saw it? Now, Warrengon was there too. And he was standing beside the governor and glancing about. And at this point, Warrengon is unconcerned. He's interested. Okay. And he suddenly, a thought occurs to Rook. He's hoping that Tagaran isn't watching him from behind the trees. He's just hoping that Tagaran's not going to be exposed to this brutality. And so Rook, and if this point, what, how would he react? Would he break ranks? Remember, he feels really protective of Tagaran. We just saw that in the last scene where Tagaran has a sleepover, and he just feels this paternal, like father-like protectiveness of her, and this deep affection that he's only really ever felt before with Anne, and maybe even more than that, because this is the first time he's been playful and he's been able to laugh. And anyway, he stood at attention with his musket at the slope. He was already sweating in his jacket. His heart was thudding and the thing had not started. I think this physical description, the sweat could be heat, but it could also be worry and concern. And the governor tries to explain to Warrigan, says, a bad man stole food. Now, I wonder in the indigenous culture whether the theft of food would even be a thing. Like, don't they share like they have shared ownership of the land and they belong to the land and they share everything that they have. And there's like, I think this concept of stealing food might not even exist. So the man took food that did not belong to him. Warrigan nodded, but Rook doesn't think he has any real understanding. So we punish. If he steals, he is punished. And Rook narrates that this magnificent idea, the product of hundreds of years of British civilization, is spelled out so plain. And then they bring out the flogger. They took out the, shook out the cat, separates the tails. Now, a cat of nine tails is, I've drawn a very poorly drawn image here, but it's the cat for short. That's cat of nine tails. It's a whip that has nine, and they've got knots in there too. And it's a pretty particularly brutal form of punishment. And he tests it out, and even the birds seem to have fallen silent. Notice the anticipation, or in almost symbolic rejection of this action that's going to happen, perhaps. You might metaphorically analyze that bit. And so Rook stands straight. He starts thinking about the muscles in his back and how amazing is this, or ingenious is this mechanism of the spine that holds his body upright no matter what's going on inside his head. So he's clearly distressed by this fact, and he imagines this carved replica of himself. So he imagines himself not as himself, but a replica that's been carved, like unmoving. And then Rooks says he was performing a species of magic, or trying to, removing himself. So by imagining that replica, I think he's removing himself from the place and time he occupied, but leaving his body there, staring into the distance. He wanted to be anywhere but there. And here, at the first sickening crack of the knots against the skin, the prisoner cried out, but so did someone else. Rook saw Warrigan trying to rush forward, shouting at the flogger, the person who is flogging, his face distorted, and he strains against the governor, holding him back, and looks wildly around at the Marines in their ranks. He met Rook's eyes and shouted to him some word over and over. So he's begging Rook here, do something, do something. We don't know exactly what he's saying, but we can infer. It's clear that Warrigan is appalled by this act of violence. He doesn't understand it. He's appalled, horrified, disgusted, dismayed. Think of some great words that you could use here. Lieutenant Rook looked away. He stiffened his neck further, back into his collar. He gripped the butt of his musket more tightly. Okay. His collar was choking him. His cap was squeezing his head, and his jacket seemed made of iron. And I think that's like, think about the jacket made of iron. Now, metaphorically, the jacket represents the British imperial machine. Okay, because we talked about the red coats that represent the government. And so the fact that it's made of iron, symbolically, it is unyielding, uncompromising, hard, heavy. So through the description of the jacket that's made of iron, Grenville suggests that the pressure and force of the belonging to the Marines and the Imperial machine is unyielding, uncompromising, hard and heavy. This is a burden. Does that make sense? And even this description, the collar was choking him metaphorically as his role as Marine and servant of the of His Majesty's army is also choking him. Okay. Stop, stop, stop was the only word his brain could produce. Stop. He's trying to say this. He wants to say this. Stop, drop the whip, walk away. But instead, he clenches his hands around the gun and he squeezes his toes. And he was stone, a piece of wood, a replica of a man. And so a technique there, we describe himself as all of these inanimate objects. It's a metaphor. So he's not really a stone or a piece of wood or a replica of a man. So that modiphoric description, it's also combined with a synderton. Okay, there's no and in there as he lists all the things. And here, Surgeon Waymark and I can't remember, Major Wyatt, I think it is, grab a hold of Warrington's arms and they're saying, "Bad man, thief, he took food." And Warrington stopped struggling. His face was turned away from where this man's back was methodically being reduced to a red pulp. Notice the violence there in the descriptions. And the imagery here is graphic and brutal. And at each stroke and cry, Warrington flinches. And this is justice, the British way. It's impartial, blind, and noble. The horror of it is proof of its impartiality. If it didn't hurt, it wasn't justice. That was what the government was trying to convey. Here, oh, listen to this. This is horrific. The rook heard the shocking, wet slap of the cat landing on split flesh 20, 30, 50 times. At each stroke, the man's body convulsed against the ropes that held him to the triangle. Here, this is the worst part. The flogger had to stop and comb his fingers through the tails of the whip after each lash to clear the flesh that clogged them. So imagine like the flesh, like the like meat that's clogging up the whip and having to put your hands through them to clear it. The prisoner endured 74 lashes before his body sagged, and the surgeon had to judge. And so next time, because 200 lashes is the punishment, next time there's 126 left. And when he is cut down, Warrington's mouth is still a particular strained shape. His disapproval is clear from his body language. He was kind of grey, like ash-like in his face, staring down, and Rook thought he might be about to vomit. The governor touched his arm and says, "It's over, my friend." But at his touch, Warrington flung up his arm as if the governor's hands were red hot. Again, this rejection of the acts of violence is clear of the punishment in the body language description. And the governor tries to give him something to eat, but Warrington did not even look at the governor or any of the assembled Berewell girl. He didn't even glance at Rook. Through lacking that eye contact, the disapproval, the rejection is evident. But Warrington was not thinking punishment, justice, impartial. All he could see was that the Berewell girl had gathered in their best clothes to inflict pain beyond imagining on one of their own. Seen through his eyes, this ceremony was not an unfortunate but necessary part of the grand machine of civilization. I think that's irony too there. But it looked like a choice. And all that remained was cruelty. And Rook had been a part of it. He had not cried out with horror or rushed forward to put an end to it. He looked away when Warrington calls to him. He'd chosen to look away. No one had held him there. He made that choice because he was a lieutenant in His Majesty's Marine Force. There it was, in the very words, force. Force was his job. If he was a soldier, then he was as much part of that cruelty as the man who had wielded the whip. And so this is another key turning point for Rook, because he has to, like, remember, you've had the turning points from the past. You've had his experience at war. You've had that moment of the shield splitting. You've had the hanging of the mutineer, but, and learning about Gardiner's having to like regretting obeying. But here I think there's a sense of shame at being involved. His involvement, especially because he's starting to have closeness with the indigenous people. And now I've written here, these are some notes that I wrote actually in the book itself. The innocence of the worldview of the natives, Chuck's deposed with. So Kate Grenville juxtaposes the innocence of the worldview of the natives with the supposed civilization of the Europeans, which is quite barbaric. And in hindsight, I'm going to take out the word innocence because innocence can be both positive and negative. In some ways, it could be naive or like, but I think it's actually presented by Grenville really positively. So I would suggest that it's this purity of the worldview of the natives. They're horrified by this punishment that they inflict on their own. That there's a goodness and a nobility to the way that they think people should treat each other. That's not evident in the supposed civilization of the British conquerors and invaders. And so that's the end of that little section. I hope you've got something out of it. You've got some good notes, and I'll see you in the next video.